Today we are going to talk about neuromuscular junction, how the information transfer from the neurons to the muscles, right? That is also called neuromuscular transmission. You know that information comes from to the skeletal muscle. Let's suppose I'm talking about my biceps muscle. It is connected with the spinal cord with the motor neurons. So the motor neurons in the spinal cord, which are supplying the information to the biceps skeletal muscle, and we have to see how this information moves from the motor neuron to the skeletal muscle membrane. Right? Let's suppose that here is your spinal cord. Right? And this is a section of spinal cord, and you must be knowing that there are anterior horn and there are posterior horn. An anterior horn or motor horn, from where the motor neurons come out. These motor neurons, which are coming out from the anterior horn, they are destined to supply the neuromuscular junction, the junction between the nerve and the muscle, right? So what really happens, this is a neuron which is coming out, and this neuron, let's suppose, is, yeah, this is a neuron here. This is cell body, right? This is the axon coming. I have enlarged the ending of this neuron, and ending of this neuron is called? Yeah, nerve terminal. And this nerve terminal is connected with the muscle. This is right, which is innervating the muscle cell and stimulating the muscle cell, which is response. Let's suppose I draw a muscle cell here. This is a muscle cell, and where muscle cell become near to the nerve ending, there it makes multiple fold, and this is, suppose here is a muscle cell. Now what we have to see is, what we have to learn today, that how action potential coming on the motor neurons, right, bringing electrochemical signals or electrical signals, action potentials are electrical signals. When action potentials or electrical signals, which are coming from the spinal cord on the membrane of the motor neuron, when they reach at the nerve ending, right, how they take the information, stimulatory information, from the nerve ending to the muscle. Is that right? Actually, what really happens, that action potentials which are coming on the motor neuron surface at the nerve ending, they lead to the release of chemical neurotransmitter, and that chemical neurotransmitter will bind with the receptors on muscle membrane, right? This part of the muscle membrane, this part of the muscle cell membrane, is called motor end plate. What is it called? Motor end plate. Because this part of the membrane of the muscle cell is connected with the motor neuron, and this plate of the membrane, it will receive the chemical message from the nerve ending, and then this plate will convert the chemical message into electrical message. I will explain everything step by step. First of all, information coming as electrical signals in the membrane, right? From here, chemical substance come out. It means electrical signals are converted into chemical signals. Then chemical signals, the chemical substances, stimulate the nerve motor end plate. And then at motor end plate, again electrical signals are generated. Is that right? And of course, later on we'll study those electrical signals which are generated here, their action potential in the what? Muscle membrane, which will eventually lead to the stimulation of the muscle contractility machinery, which we'll discuss later. Today's topic is only to understand how the action potential or electrical information coming on the neuron surface is converted into chemical information or chemical signals, and how chemical signals go to the motor end plate, and when chemical signals come to the motor end plate, how they again convert the chemical signals into electrical signals, right? And this transfer of information or signals from the motor nerve ending to the motor end plate, this whole information process, which is transferred electrical information, chemical information, again electrical information, this process is called neuromuscular transmission. What is this process called? Neuromuscular transmission. That there is transmission of signals from the neuron to the muscle. So this is about neuromuscular transmission. Is that right? And this area where nerve ending, right, motor nerve ending and motor end plate from the muscle, they are coming together. Whole this area is called neuromuscular junction. What is it called? Neuromuscular junction. So what we say that at neuromuscular junctions, there is neuromuscular transmission. This is our today's topic. What is neuromuscular junction and how neuromuscular transmission occurs? Simply what we are going to discuss, how the motor neurons talk to the muscle. How the motor neurons talk to the muscles, that muscles should contract. That's what is our today's work. Okay. First of all, as I told you, when electrical signals are coming here, they lead to the release of chemical substances. So it means this nerve ending should have some chemical substances which should be released as chemical signals. Those chemical substances which are accumulated and stored in this nerve ending, those chemical substances are called neurotransmitters. What are these? Neurotransmitters. What are neurotransmitters? These are special chemical substances which are present in the nerve endings, and they are released from one nerve ending, right, to transfer the signals to the postsynaptic membrane. The junction of the, look, what is synapse? Synapse is the meeting point of the membranes of two cells where information can be transferred from one cell to the next cell. What is synapse? Synapse is a meeting point of the two membranes of two cells where information from one cell can be transferred to the other cell. And because at neuromuscular junction, the synapse is made between the neuronal membrane and muscular membrane. And in this synapse, the information passes through a chemical neurotransmitter. That is why neuromuscular junctions are classified as chemical synapses. How they are classified? They are called chemical synapses, because in this synapse, in this contact point, right, information is transferred from one cell to the next cell by the chemical substance. So we call these such type of synapses chemical synapses. So when we study in detail neuromuscular junction and neuromuscular transmission, we are studying a classical case of chemical synaptic activity. Am I right? And this membrane is called presynaptic membrane, and this is called postsynaptic membrane. Presynaptic membrane will talk and postsynaptic membrane will listen. Presynaptic membrane will release the chemical substances and postsynaptic membrane will have a receptor for that. It keeps on talking, it keeps on listening. This is something like ideal couple as female imagine. What is the ideal couple? Female always talk, men always listen. Is that right? So it is only one-way transmission. This is only one-way transmission, right? You cannot get the reverse direction. Is that right? The neurons always talk and muscles always listen. Is that right? At neuromuscular junctions. At neuromuscular junction. So this transmission is two-way or one-way?
One-way.
It is one-way. So let's see how the neurons talk and how the muscles listen, and after that how the muscles start their action, right? That we'll discuss later. Okay, first of all, they should have a chemical substance. So from the chemical substance at neuromuscular junction at the skeletal muscle is acetylcholine. The chemical substance is acetylcholine. So within these neurons, there are special type of membrane-bound vesicles, and in those membrane-bound vesicles, these are the molecules of, yes, acetylcholine. There are thousands and thousands of the molecules of acetylcholine well concentrated in the synaptic vesicles of nerve ending. Is that right? Nerve ending has thousands of such membrane-bound vesicles, and they are loaded with acetylcholine. It means that we should know from where the acetylcholine comes and from where the vesicles come. Is that right? We should know from where the acetylcholine comes and from where the vesicles come. First of all, we talk about these vesicles, right? These vesicles, from where they come. Yes. Who has any idea from where these vesicles come, which are loaded with acetylcholine? Right. Are these vesicles synthesized in this nerve ending, or are these vesicles coming from the cell body of the neuron? Yeah. The question is that the question is that there are thousands and thousands of vesicular you can say vesicles there, in which you can store the neurotransmitters. These bags of the neurotransmitters are basically membrane bound vesicles with very special type of proteins which help in storage and capture of the, you can say, neurotransmitter. These vesicles are not synthesized in nerve ending. These are synthesized in the cell body. Why they are synthesized in cell body? Because these vesicles have very special type of proteins in their membrane. And you know, proteins are synthesized from messenger RNA. You know, messenger RNA are translated in protein, and messenger RNA are produced by the DNA transcription. So it means DNA should be transcribed into messenger RNA, and then messenger RNA should be translated into proteins. And if this vesicle has proteins, then those proteins must be coming from some place where there should be DNA. And there's no DNA in this nerve ending. Where is DNA?
Cell bodies.
So that is a logical reason that why actually all the different type of proteins, listen carefully, all the different type of proteins which are present on this very specialized nerve ending, all those proteins are synthesized in the cell body and transported all the way down to this nerve ending. Because nerve ending does not have nucleus. Nerve ending does not have genetic material. It does not have genetic program to make proteins. So this is the basic principle in all the neurons. Whatever proteins are present at nerve endings, there are proteins which help in storage of neurotransmitters, there are proteins which help in movement of the vesicles, there are proteins and enzymes which help in synthesis of neurotransmitters, there are proteins which help in the uptake of neurotransmitter or reuptake of neurotransmitter or uptake of neurotransmitter precursor molecule. All these proteins which are present in this nerve ending, they are coming from, yes please,
cell bodies.
And then gradually, very, very slowly, through the exoplasm, they are coming to the nerve. Out that these vesicles, which are having special type of, let me draw one vesicle out. Let us suppose this is vesicular membrane. Actually, this membrane has very special type of transporter proteins within it, right? Which can transport that neurotransmitter and concentrate it inside. Number one. Number two, these vesicles have also another special type of proteins which help the vesicle to fuse with the neuronal membrane. So these vesicles are loaded with special type of proteins, and as I said, that proteins can only be synthesized in the cell body and not in the nerve ending. So these vesicles are synthesized in the cell body, right, where we have the DNA, we have the genes which will be transcribed into messenger RNAs, and those messenger RNAs will be translated into different proteins, and all those proteins will come down to the nerve ending through the axon. Here some proteins will be part of the vesicle, some, right, and pumping the neurotransmitter in. There will be other proteins on the surface of vesicle which will help the vesicle on stimulation to bind with the neuronal membrane, right? But when these vesicles are produced and they are coming down through the exoplasmic flow and they reach here, originally these vesicles are empty. These are empty bags. Let's suppose there is a bag which is empty bag and it doesn't have any neurotransmitter. Now, from where the acetylcholine comes? Acetylcholine is, okay, I will ask you, acetylcholine is produced in the nerve ending, or it is coming from the cell body? Answer is absolutely wrong. That acetylcholine is not coming from the cell body. It is a very small molecular weight neurotransmitter. All the small molecular weight neurotransmitters are synthesized in the nerve terminal. Is that right? So it means actually acetylcholine is synthesized in the nerve ending, but the enzymes and different proteins which are required for synthesis, storage and release of the acetylcholine, all those proteins are coming from the cell bodies. So you can say the machines, right, the factories which synthesize, store and release the neurotransmitter, those proteins are coming from the cell body, but acetylcholine is synthesized locally in the nerve ending. So nerve ending is semi-autonomous unit which can synthesize the neurotransmitter, which can store the neurotransmitter, which can release the neurotransmitter, and sometimes, not in case of acetylcholine, but sometimes some neurotransmitters by some nerve endings are recaptured. So nerve ending is a very important biological semi-autonomous functional unit. So we see how this particular specific type of nerve ending works. Actually, this nerve ending has proteins in its membrane, and these proteins are choline transporters. These proteins are choline transporters, and what these proteins are doing, they are actively transporting the choline from extracellular fluid to the nerve ending. In this way, from where the choline is coming, of course you must be knowing, you have a gastrointestinal system and you eat so many funny things, and some of these things have choline, and choline is absorbed from the GIT into your circulatory system, and then choline comes to extracellular fluid all over the body. So all over the body extracellular fluid is having choline, and wherever such nerve endings which are cholinergic nerve endings are dangling into what? Extracellular fluid, they have these special transporter which are helping these nerve endings to concentrate the choline from extracellular environment into intracellular area. So they are choline transporters in the nerve ending membrane. And of course you will remember these choline transporters are coming from the cell body because they are special type of proteins. Is that right? But don't tell anyone that choline is coming from all the way down, right? So once choline come out, now actually to make acetylcholine, we should fuse the choline with acetyl-CoA, right? Acetate. So what really happens, that there are mitochondria in the nerve ending. There are mitochondria in the nerve ending, and mitochondria provide acetate. You know, mitochondria synthesize, mitochondria have acetyl-CoA, and acetyl-CoA can be converted into acetate, or simply acetyl coenzyme A. Now acetyl CoA is coming from the mitochondrion, is that right, which are present normally in the nerve ending, and choline is captured by the special transporter from extracellular environment and concentrated into this. Then this acetyl CoA and choline, they are put together and they are fused, and when they are fused together, right, this choline and, so acetyl-CoA and choline, right, they are fused together, and when they fuse together, they make a molecule, and that molecule is called acetyl-choline. Now this acetyl-choline formation, right, is done by the help of an enzyme, and what is the name of that enzyme? Choline acetyl transferase. Right, the enzyme which is doing this function, that enzyme is called, this is the enzyme, and this enzyme is responsible for this reaction, is that right? And that this enzyme is actually helping the choline and acetyl CoA to come together and to make acetyl choline. So what is the name of this enzyme? Yes. Okay, little bit. What was this transporter? Choline transporter. And this enzyme, right, it is called choline acetyl transferase. transferase. Now, from where this enzyme is coming? It has from where this enzyme is coming? Can you tell me? This must be coming from the cell body because enzyme is a protein. It's a difficult thing, it's a basic principle. Isn't it? All proteins are synthesized from the cell body and transported to this very special small autonomous factory of neurotransmitter synthesis, storage and release system. Is that right? So up to now, what did we learn? That nerve ending is having choline concentrating transporters, and they have mitochondria which provide acetyl-CoA. So the choline and acetyl-CoA are fused together by the help of choline acetyl transferase, and the resulting molecule is called acetylcholine. And this acetylcholine should be appropriately stored. And for storage purpose, what really happens, that your friend, I told you there are vesicles, right? And these vesicles are very having very special type of, what are these? Transporters. What are these transporting proteins? These proteins are actually sensitive, transporting proteins are sensitive to the presence of acetylcholine. And as soon as acetylcholine is formed, it is transported into the
vesicles.
And then your vesicle become very rich in acetylcholine. So acetylcholine is concentrated into these vesicles. Am I clear? No problem up to this? In this way, we have synthesized the chemical signaling molecule and stored into the nerve ending. Now we have to see still another step, that when electrical information or wave of depolarization is coming here, how it lead to the release of neurotransmitter and how neurotransmitter binds with the postsynaptic membrane or with the muscle end plate, and how on the muscle end plate electrical events start and eventually muscle membrane develop action potentials. We have to discuss how the action potential coming on the neurons convert into chemical signals and chemical substance is released, and how chemical substance generates local potential and eventually action potential on the membrane. Now let's start with it. All of you must be knowing that when wave of when action potential is coming here on the membrane, it means wave of depolarization followed by the wave of repolarization is approaching the nerve ending, right? So when spinal cord stimulates this motor neuron, wave of depolarization is moving down. You know, when wave of depolarization is moving down, what are these channels? Voltage gated sodium channels. So voltage gated sodium channels bring lot of sodium in, and this when wave of sodium influx is coming, naturally what happened, that if resting membrane potential was minus 70 millivolt, so as soon as sodium comes in, right, then membrane become depolarized, maybe it become plus 10 millivolt. Is that right? So what is really happening, that when wave of depolarization approaches to the nerve ending, it produces heavy sodium influx, and that sodium influx reverses the polarity of the inner side of the membrane from resting membrane position to depolarization. So as soon as nerve ending is depolarized, now this is the point to understand, as soon as action potential or wave of depolarization approaches the nerve ending, and as soon as nerve ending is depolarized, nerve ending activates its very special depolarization sensitive calcium channels. What are there? There are depolarization sensitive calcium channels. So these depolarization sensitive calcium channels, they will be activated, and you know calcium is well concentrated inside the neuron or outside the neuron? Yeah, calcium is more concentrated in extracellular fluid. So as soon as you can say wave of depolarization reaches here, as soon as wave of depolarization reaches here to the nerve ending, it will produce the depolarization of the nerve ending, and then depolarization sensitive, for example, it's become 10 plus 10 millivolt, right? And you can say that nerve ending is depolarized, then depolarization sensitive calcium channels will open, and there will be calcium influx. Am I right? There is calcium in flux, right? So you say one electrical information is converted to another. The originally action potential came as a wave of sodium and flux, and that triggered in the nerve ending wave of calcium and flux. When calcium comes in, then what happens? When calcium comes in, actually there are calcium sensitive proteins which are present on the surface of the vesicle, right? The special type of calcium sensitive proteins present on the surface of the vesicles, which are normally present all the time on these vesicles, and the calcium sensitive proteins also present on nerve cell membrane. So these are special calcium sensitive proteins. Now look, actually if this protein dock into this, if this protein fit into this pocket, both proteins will interact and contract, and this vesicular membrane will fuse with neuronal nerve ending membrane. Is that right? But these proteins can be activated by calcium. What really happens, as soon as calcium binds at these ends, some calcium at this point, some calcium at this point, both of them are positively charged, so they will be repelled. So what really happens, as soon as calcium comes in, this open up because calcium is binding here, and calcium brings some changes in these proteins also, and they are more ready to bind here. So what is the real result? That in the presence of the calcium, these proteins which are in the membrane, right, they come into active configuration, and the proteins of the vesicular membrane, they also are able to interact here. When these two proteins interact with each other, right, I've shown, of course, these proteins as very big molecule, but in proportion, these proteins are extremely small molecule on vesicular membrane as well as on nerve ending membrane. So when these proteins interact, they help the both membranes to fuse with each other, and when both membranes fuse with each other, what really happens, situation become like this, because the point where vesicular membrane and nerve ending membrane fuse, membranes dissolve and a gap is generated through which your beautiful stars will come out. What are these? Acetylcholine. In this way, there is release of neurotransmitter from the nerve ending. This process is called exocytosis of endocytosis means taking up some material. Exocytosis means release of some material. This is also called exocytosis of neurotransmitters from the nerve ending, which is calcium influx dependent. Let me tell you the name of these proteins, right? These were the proteins. This was one protein which was present on synaptic vesicle, and there were other protein which was present on the membrane, right? These proteins. This protein is called synaptobrevin. Synaptobrevin. And there are many other proteins also like this. And this protein is called syntaxin. And there are many friends of syntaxin also, right? So these proteins actually are active. Their fusion is activated by calcium influx, and these proteins help the vesicular membrane to fuse with the nerve ending membrane, so that both membranes fuse with each other, produce a gap through which neurotransmitter should come out. Yeah? Synaptobrevin. Thank you. Right? He is very sensitive about P. Right? So, synaptobrevin binds with the syntaxins, and their binding is dependent on calcium influx, and of course calcium influx is dependent on approaching depolarizing waves. Is that right? Now let's sum it up what we have discussed. We have just discussed that when action potentials are produced as electrical stimulus on the motor neurons, wave of depolarization rapidly approaches the nerve ending. When nerve ending is depolarized, then depolarization sensitive calcium channels are activated, a lot of calcium influx occur. This calcium influx stimulates the proteins on vesicular membrane and nerve ending membrane, help them to interact with each other, so that vesicular membrane and nerve ending membrane, they fuse with each other and they produce a hole through which what will happen? Neurotransmitter will come out. In this way, action potential produces calcium influx and calcium influx produces neurotransmitter release. This is simply three steps. Approaching action potential produces calcium influx in the nerve ending, and that calcium influx produces release of neurotransmitter. So these are all presynaptic events at neuromuscular junction. Now, so what really happens, I will draw multiple areas here, that so many vesicles will fuse there, and from these vesicles what is being released? Yes, please. Acetylcholine. Is that right? Now, acetylcholine has two parts. One part is postcholine, this part is choline, and this is acetate. This is choline and this is acetate, and of course this is choline and acetate. They must have choline also. Am I clear? Okay. Now, acetylcholine is released. Now, this acetylcholine concentration is more near the presynaptic membrane, and concentration here is less. So things move from high concentration to low concentration. So acetylcholine, which is released by the nerve ending, it moves from the presynaptic membrane towards the postsynaptic membrane, which is basically here nerve, sorry, muscle and plate. So by simple diffusion mechanism, neurotransmitter or acetylcholine diffuses from the presynaptic area to the postsynaptic area, and this gap between the presynaptic membrane and postsynaptic membrane is called synaptic cleft. What is it called? Synaptic cleft. Is that right? Now what we'll see, what are the events which happen here? Actually, here are acetylcholine receptors. Is that right? If someone is talking to you, you must have ears. So here is a tongue and here are the ears. Unfortunately, it has only tongues and it has only ears, maybe fortunately, right? So this is one-way transmission, right? So the acetylcholine sensitive special type of receptors are here. These receptors are very, very special type of channels. One, two, three, four, five. These are pentameric proteins. Pentameric proteins mean these are special type of five proteins come together and making a channel. And of course, there is alpha protein. There are two alpha proteins, beta, gamma, delta proteins. But no need to remember that detail. But if you want to, it's so simple. Two alpha plus one beta, one gamma, one delta. So all these chains, two alpha chains, one beta chain, one gamma chain, one delta chain, they assemble together to make this special type of channel. Now, in this, actually, on the sides of these, there's one point here and there is another point here. These are the points which act as receiving point for acetylcholine. If there is no acetylcholine binding here, the central pore remain closed. But as soon as acetylcholine diffuses here and binds here, they become loaded with acetylcholine. So then these channels will open. It means these channels are not voltage gated, they are ligand gated. Ligand means some specific chemical substance. These are acetylcholine operated ion channels. What are these? Acetylcholine sensitive ion channels or acetylcholine gated ion channels, or simply ligand gated. It's a type of ligand gated ion channels. Now what really happens? Let me make it more simple. Let's suppose I show three of these channels here. What are these? These channels are primarily acetylcholine receptors. What are these channels? These are acetylcholine receptors. These are expressed on nerve. These are expressed on the muscle and plate, right? At the postsynaptic junction of neuromuscular junction. Is that right? So these are the ears of the what? Muscles to listen to the chemical transmission of cholinergic chemical transmission of nerve, motor nerve ending. Right? As soon as this acetylcholine binds at these places, what happens? These channels open. When these channels open, they allow the cations to move. Right? These channels allow the movement of the cations. Now cations which are outside are sodium, and cations which are inside are potassium. Because they allow the free movement of the cations, right? So sodium will move in and potassium will move out. Is that right? But before the acetylcholine could bind with these channels, and before these channels could open, this muscle was having resting membrane potential of minus 70 millivolt. Let's suppose this muscle was having resting membrane potential of minus 70 or minus 80 millivolt. Now listen, this was having resting membrane potential of minus 80 millivolt. So resting membrane potential of the muscle membrane is more near to the equilibrium potential of potassium, or more near to the equilibrium potential of sodium? Potassium. You know, potassium has the equilibrium potential of minus 85 millivolt, and sodium has equilibrium potential of plus 65 millivolt. So it means before the acetylcholine mediated stimulation of these channels, there was resting membrane potential on the motor end plate, and this resting membrane potential was a voltage which was more near to the potassium equilibrium potential. So as soon as acetylcholine is released and diffuses down and stimulate the acetylcholine receptors, what are acetylcholine receptors? Acetylcholine receptors are acetylcholine sensitive cationic channels. Another thing, in these pockets, if I make this channel here, if this is the channel, right? I told you there's one pocket here, another pocket here. In these pocket, not only acetylcholine can fit, but this is acetylcholine, and this part of the acetylcholine, this triangular part of acetylcholine, fits into this area. There is another chemical substance which is like this, that alone can also fit here and stimulate it. This substance is not acetylcholine. This substance is nicotine. So these channels can also be stimulated by nicotine. So these are also called nicotinic channels. They are also called nicotinic acetylcholine channels, because there are other channels of there are other receptors for acetylcholine which can not be stimulated by nicotine. They can be stimulated by muscarine. I will not go into that detail today, but for a while I just mentioned that these acetylcholine receptor channels which are present on the motor end plate, these channels can also be stimulated by nicotine. So they are also called nicotinic channels, and these are acetylcholine sensitive channels which also responds to nicotine. So these are called nicotinic cholinergic receptors. What are these called? Receptors. Nicotinic cholinergic receptors. So what are nicotinic cholinergic receptors? These are nicotine as well as acetylcholine sensitive receptor channels which are present on the motor end plate, where acetylcholine will bind and these channels will open. These are cationic channels. They allow the cations to move across the membrane down their electrochemical gradients. We were discussing that as soon as when these channels are opening, just before they open, the resting membrane potential of the motor end plate is near the equilibrium potential of potassium, and it is far away from the equilibrium potential of the sodium. You know already from previous lectures that whenever a membrane becomes highly permeable to a specific ion, that ion will move down its electrochemical gradient and try to take the membrane potential towards its own equilibrium potential. Now, because Now sodium can go in and potassium can go out. Is that right? So sodium will sodium influx will try to take the membrane potential towards its own equilibrium potential, and potassium will try to maintain the membrane potential near its own equilibrium potential. As soon as these ion channels open, membrane is already near to the potassium equilibrium potential. So potassium will not move in massive amount, but membrane is far away from sodium equilibrium potential. So sodium will move in very high concentration from outside to inside. Am I clear? Right. So even though there is a little potassium efflux, but mainly there is a heavy influx of sodium. So this sodium, which is coming out through these acetylcholine receptors, the sodium influx make progressively, as more and more sodium is coming in, it progressively make the membrane potential less and less negative, and it become minus, from minus 80 it become minus 60, minus 40, minus 20, and most of the time it become 0 millivolt. This is zero, not anything else. 0 millivolt. So it means membrane which was negatively polarized, now it is depolarized. So if there is enough acetylcholine present, and there are enough acetylcholine receptors and channels responsive, then enough sodium will come in to depolarize the membrane and take the membrane potential from the resting membrane potential to, let's suppose, 0 millivolt. Am I clear? There's no problem in this. Now, one thing which is very important to understand. Usually, when action potential come on the nerve ending, lot of calcium influx occur and thousands of the vesicles release lot of acetylcholine, and lot of acetylcholine stimulates many, many cholinergic postsynaptic nicotinic receptors, and lot of sodium comes in and depolarizes the membrane. Now, this is not action potential. When resting membrane potential from minus 80 has gone up to zero, it is not action potential, it is just a local potential. And because this local potential is produced at the end plate, so we simply call it end plate potential. What is it? Potential. So we say when resting membrane potential from minus 80 goes to 0 millivolt, so 0 millivolt is motor end plate potential. Is that right? Or simply we call it end plate potential, motor end plate potential. Now, one thing which is very important to know, this end plate potential from minus 80 to 0 is not produced by the contents of only one synaptic vesicle. Let's imagine what is the smallest fluctuation which can be produced here. Smallest fluctuation can be produced by release of the contents of single vesicle. Let's suppose, theoretically speaking, that if only one vesicle releases its content and no other vesicle release, then very small amount of acetylcholine will come. There will be very little stimulation of cholinergic receptor, very little sodium will come in, right? And in that case, membrane potential will fluctuate maybe only 0.0.4 millivolt. Is it a large fluctuation? Even this fluctuation is less than 1 millivolt. This fluctuation is less than 1 millivolt. Again, let me repeat it. If, hypothetically speaking, if only one vesicle releases its acetylcholine, that is such a small amount of acetylcholine that it will do such so little stimulation of cholinergic receptors and channels that such a small amount of sodium influx will occur that there will be very little fluctuation in local potential, maybe only 0.4 millivolt. Right, this type of very small fluctuation by single content of the single cholinergic vesicle is called miniature end plate potential. What is it called? Miniature end plate potential. So we can say that when, now listen carefully, what is miniature end plate potential? Miniature is a very small end plate potential. This is the smallest possible. You cannot have end plate potential less than this, right? Miniature end plate potential is really a miniature end plate potential, very small end plate potential, which is produced by the release of content of acetylcholine from a single vesicle, which produces so less stimulation of cholinergic receptors, so small amount of sodium influx is produced, that there is very little fluctuation in resting membrane potential, or very little membrane fluctuation is produced. For example, if it was minus 80 millivolt, it will become just minus 79.6 millivolt. It's a very small fluctuation. We call it miniature end plate potential. Now, what really happens? This is also called quantal release. This is the smallest quanta of acetylcholine which could be released. You cannot release less than that. At least one packet of acetylcholine should be released. So when one vesicle or one packet of acetylcholine or one quantum of acetylcholine is released, this is responsible to produce miniature end plate potential. But in fact, in a healthy neuromuscular transmission, the neuronal depolarization produces so much influx of the calcium in the nerve ending that thousands and thousands of the, not many, many of the vesicles are released, and many miniature end potential, miniature end plate potentials are produced simultaneously, and they are submitted together, they are added together, right, to produce the full end plate potential. But again, you have to remember, this full end plate potential is just a local fluctuation in the end plate region. Full end plate potential is not action potential, because it is not due to voltage gated sodium channel, it is produced due to ligand gated sodium channels. But once enough sodium has come in, what this sodium will do, this sodium will go to the surrounding area, is that right? And on the neighboring area, there are, what are these? Voltage gated sodium channels. These are present on the flanks of motor and plate, right? So what really happens, that when motor and plate undergoes the process of depolarization, and this depolarization is end plate potential, this end plate potential actually takes the flanking part of the membrane on the sides of the motor end plate, it takes that part of the membrane from resting voltage to threshold voltage. Is that right? So what really happened, that I can write here that end plate potential here and end plate potential here, it will take the resting membrane potential to threshold potential. This end plate potential will take on the flanking region resting membrane potential up to, yes please, threshold potential. At threshold potential, right, what will happen? Voltage gated sodium channels will open and heavy amount of sodium influx will start. And as you know from previous lectures, that when sodium influx occurs, heavy sodium influx occurs due to the voltage activation of the voltage gated channel on the muscle membrane, right, this sodium will stimulate the next area. Is that right? This depolarizing current will take the neighboring part of the muscle membrane to threshold, and this will undergo depolarization, and this will take the next area to threshold, and that will undergo depolarization. So what really happens, that wave of depolarization will rapidly sweep over the all the muscle cell membrane. Is that right? How that depolarization triggers the muscle contraction, that we will study in future lectures when I will teach you electromechanical coupling, that how the electrical activity eventually gets coupled with mechanical contraction. Is that right? Not today. Today our discussion is only how the information is transferred from the motor neurons to the muscle membrane, right, which is called neuromuscular transmission at neuromuscular junctions. Is that right? There's no difficulty. So this was the basic concept of neuromuscular junction. Let me revise it for you rapidly. What really happens at neuromuscular junction? When in spinal cord, cell bodies or neurons, motor neurons are stimulated, these motor neurons generate action potentials, and these action potentials are going down the membrane of the motor neurons, right? So when these action potentials, wave of depolarization approaches the, what is this? Nerve terminal. There is depolarization sensitive calcium channels present only at the nerve ending. These deposition sensitive calcium channels were not present throughout. They were only present at the nerve ending. So nerve ending undergoes, develops calcium influx. Then calcium influx mediated stimulation of vesicular proteins and nerve ending membrane proteins occur, and these proteins interaction produces the fusion of vesicular membranes with the nerve ending membrane, and neurotransmitters are released. As soon as neurotransmitter is released, here the neurotransmitter was acetylcholine. Acetylcholine is released, it diffuses down the synaptic cleft to the motor end plate. There at the motor end plate, it finds nicotinic cholinergic receptors, which are special ion channels which are sensitive and operated by the acetylcholine. As soon as acetylcholine bind with these channels, this produces allows the movement of cations, right? Potassium will move out and sodium will move inside the cell. But because membrane was initially more near to the potassium equilibrium potential and far away from the sodium equilibrium potential, so heavy sodium influx is generated, and that takes the resting membrane potential of the end plate to not here is not threshold, it takes to depolarization. Is that right? Remember, if there's only one vesicle releases its acetylcholine, right, there is very small influx of sodium produced, and very small fluctuation in the local potential is called miniature end plate potential. But normally many vesicles of acetylcholine release their contents, and lot of cholinergic nicotinic receptors are activated, a lot of sodium influx occur, and resting membrane potential fluctuate from minus 80 value to approximately 0 millivolt. So its negative polarity is completely lost, so membrane in this region, motor end plate region, will become completely depolarized. Once this membrane become depolarized, this is called end plate potential, local potential. It is still not called action potential. Then this motor end plate potential is responsible to take the neighboring resting membrane potential to threshold, and neighboring membrane, the muscle cell membrane, which is in the neighboring region of end plate area, this neighboring membrane is having lot of voltage sensitive sodium channels. So when end plate potential take the resting membrane potential in the flanking area from towards the threshold, and as soon as threshold potential is achieved, voltage gated sodium channels open and heavy influx of sodium is produced, and that depolarizes that part of the membrane, and that depolarizes the next area, and so and so forth. Wave of depolarization moves on the muscle membrane, followed by of course wave of repolarization. Right, we have discussed it already how it happens. So in this way, actually the action potentials which were coming on the neuronal membrane, right, those action potential were electrical signals. By release of the neurotransmitter, those signals were converted into chemical signals, and chemical signals approach the postsynaptic membrane and again produce electrical signals, and when these electrical signals start flowing, we say action potential of the neuron through the neuromuscular transmission have produced action potential of the muscle membrane. This is how neurons talk intimately to the muscles. Is that right? But there's one thing. This talk should have its limit, isn't it? It should not be continuous talk. So, actually, this acetylcholine which has been released, it should not stay there forever. Right? For this purpose, nature has been very kind to us, that there are special type of enzymes, and these enzymes are present on the membrane of, as well as in the extracellular matrix of neuromuscular junction. In the neuromuscular junction, these special type of enzymes are present. Where they are present? They are present within the extracellular matrix, as well as they are present on motor end plate membrane. These enzymes, what they will do, that they will cache the acetylcholine and break it down into choline and acetate. They will break it down into choline and acetate. Acetate will diffuse away through the blood. It may go to the liver and used for some other purposes. This choline is very variable. It will be again pumped back. Is that right? So these are the enzymes which are responsible to catabolize the neurotransmitter, and acetylcholine is broken by the action of these enzymes into choline and acetate. Acetate diffuses out and choline is again reabsorbed. Why? Because this nerve ending cannot produce the choline, but it can produce acetate from its mitochondria. It's so intelligent. It can produce its own acetate, so it doesn't really use energy to pick it up. But because it cannot synthesize choline, so 50% of the choline, acetylcholine, which is catabolized, its choline is reuptaken so that it can be recycled, and again, synthesis of acetylcholine can be done. These enzymes are called, acetylcholine esterases. What are the name of these enzymes? These enzymes are called acetylcholinesterases. These are acetylcholinesterases. Right, these enzymes are present at the neuromuscular junction and they are responsible to destroy the acetylcholine once it has done its action. So we call them simply acetylcholinesterases. Acetylcholine esterases, right? They produce the hydrolysis of acetylcholine and breakdown of acetylcholine into acetate and choline. In this way, they help the neuromuscular junction to terminate the action of acetylcholine. If neuron want more action in the muscle, then neuron will bring more action potential and release more acetylcholine, and again, action potentials will be set up. Am I clear? There's no problem here. Right, let's have a break. Thank you. Right, so we were talking about that when action potential reaches to the nerve ending, right, then depolarization sensitive calcium channels are open, calcium influx occur. That calcium actually leads to the interaction of synaptobrevin and syntaxins, and that results in fusion of the vesicular membrane with the nerve ending membrane and release of acetylcholine. And this acetylcholine passes through the synaptic cleft, fuses with the nicotinicholinergic receptors, which are cationic channels, and produce sodium influx and little potassium efflux. But this dominating sodium influx take the resting membrane potential of minus 80 millivolt to zero millivolt. So this part of the membrane, which is motor end plate, eventually gets depolarized. And this depolarization takes the neighboring area of the membrane to threshold, and then voltage sensitive calcium sodium channels open, and wave of depolarization starts on the muscle membrane, and which sweeps over the muscle. This wave of depolarization followed by wave of repolarization and action potential. In this way, what we have discussed, that acetylcholine which was released, right, it produced the, what was that, end plate potential, but after that immediately it is attacked by acetylcholine esterases. We destroy the acetylcholine and terminate the action of acetylcholine, and a breakdown product of acetylcholine is choline and acetate. Acetate diffuses out of neuromuscular junction to extracellular fluid and eventually to the, what is that, general circulation, going to the liver. But choline is recaptured by the nerve ending and reused for the synthesis of acetylcholine. One thing which we talked about, that choline we have recaptured. Acetyl-CoA can be again produced in more quantities by the mitochondria. But these vesicular membranes are not simple membranes. These are very specialized membranes, because these vesicular membranes have special transporters within the membrane, right? So when these vesicular membranes become the part of, what is this? Nerve ending membrane or neuronal membrane, right? These are very, very special type of membranes. So we should not be, we should not get these membranes lost. We should recover them, rather than asking the cell body to keep on constantly supplying very heavy traffic of the vesicles, right? We should be able to reuse these bags. So what really happens, that very, very special type of proteins, right, very, very special type of proteins appear within the within the nerve ending, and these proteins bind here with the inner side of the vesicular membrane, and then they start pulling this membrane inward. So what they are really doing, that these proteins are simply pinching the piece of that specialized membrane inward, and they keep on pulling it until this membrane is snipped off, and then vesicle is recycled back, but now it is empty. These specialized, then as soon as vesicular membrane has been reclaimed by the nerve ending, right, these proteins go away, right? And they go away where? To recapture another piece of membrane back. These special proteins are called clathrins. What are they called? Clathrins. So in this way, we synthesize and store the neurotransmitters, we release the neurotransmitter, a partial component choline is reclaimed, as well as the fused vesicular membrane with the neuronal membrane has also recaptured or reclaimed by the help of clathrins. And once they come back, they are again refilled but by newly synthesized acetylcholine. Am I clear? Now we see what type of different problems can occur to hold this system. A very important disease, which is called myasthenia gravis. Myasthenia gravis. It's a disease in which person develop progressive weakness of the muscles, right? And even very small activity fatigues the person a lot, right? Later on, when the research was done that why some people develop myasthenia gravis, they came to know that patients with myasthenia gravis have antibodies in their blood directed against these channels. So what really happens, that this is your immune headquarter, right? And it has done a mistake. That autoimmune, actually your immune system is supposed to make antibodies against the foreign proteins. But if by some defect, immune system make antibodies which are directed against cholinergic receptors, and these antibodies bind here. If these antibodies bind over here, over what? They bind with the nicotinic cholinergic receptors. When these antibodies are binding here, these are autoantibodies because they are reacting against your own tissue. This is a disease, right? These autoantibodies, which are found by the defect in the immune system, and they bind at the neuromuscular junction at the motor end plate, specifically on the nicotinic cholinergic receptors. Do you think now acetylcholine can bind here? No. So what really happens, that when we are having these antibodies in high concentration in the body, then acetylcholine failed to bind with the receptors. So what really happens when this person want to make some movement, right? Actually, from central nervous system, action potential will come down, nerve ending will develop calcium and flux, acetylcholine will be released, but acetylcholine will not be able to bind with the channel, and channel will not open. So sodium and flux will not occur, and enough end plate potential will not develop, and if enough end plate potential is not developing, then action potentials and signals on the muscle membranes are not developing. Due to these reasons, these people use a lot of willpower and effort to do even slight movement, because they have to bring a lot of signals here to get a lot of acetylcholine, so that excessive amount of acetylcholine stimulate the remaining, what is this, overstimulate the remaining few channels which are yet not blocked by the antibodies. And due to these reasons, these people develop neuromuscular transmission blockade due to autoantibodies present on nicotinic cholinergic receptors, and neuromuscular transmission become weak, muscles cannot be stimulated, right? Acetylcholine failed to produce the what? End plate potentials, right? And end plate potential, of course, are produced very small, and they may not very small end plate potential may not take the resting membrane potential up to threshold in the neighboring area, so muscles don't contract well and person develops weakness. Is that right? You know how you can treat it?
Yes.
Okay, let me tell you. There was a, yeah, how you can treat it?
No, I read
giving a special motivation to the person?
No, okay. by getting rid of
antibodies.
Whatever was getting rid of.
I will tell you.
Of the enzyme, so there's more acetylcholine. Is that one way?
I'm really confused. You are successful in confusing me. But let me tell you that what I know, right? Listen, actually, there was a drug. Okay, I will tell you something. It happened in London, actually. There was a boy, he loved his girlfriend really very much. And unfortunately, the girlfriend developed myasthenia gravis. With some exaggeration, they tell the story like this, that once the boy developed some compound, and he gave to his girlfriend, and that girlfriend with myasthenia gravis becomes so active that kept on dancing for a long time. You would like to know what was that substance? That was a substance, right? That was a substance, specific substance, which put a ring on it. And that blocked which thing? Acetylcholinesterase enzymes. So basically the substance was acetylcholinesterase blocker or inhibitor. If a drug or substance bind with the acetylcholinesterase, what was this? Enzyme, acetylcholinesterase. So this drug is acetylcholinesterase blockers. Is that right? And now you see that its active domain is present inside it, and you know it's weeping because this enzyme cannot be active. Right? This is a drug which is put on the mouth of acetylcholinesterase. So now in this person, when she was having myasthenia gravis, the problem was that whatever acetylcholine which was released in normal amount, because number of receptors available were less, so normal concentration of acetylcholine working on less receptor was producing smaller end plate potential and not getting enough stimulation to the muscular system. When this drug was given, which was acetylcholinesterase inhibitor, right, and these enzymes were inhibited, even the normal release of the acetylcholine, even though the acetylcholine is released in normal concentration, but it will not be destroyed. So it will accumulate in this area. You are understanding? When acetylcholine will accumulate in the synaptic cleft due to inhibition of acetylcholinesterases, what will happen?
You can destroy it.
Yeah, a high concentration of acetylcholine will strongly stimulate the remaining available channels, and enough sodium will go in that may produce full end plate potential and action potential start on the muscle cell membrane and weakness is disappearing. Is that right? So such drugs are now very commonly used in the patients with myasthenia gravis. These drugs are called? Yes. These drugs are called acetylcholinesterase inhibitors. The classical drugs in this group are physostigmine, neostigmine, and there are many other I will not mention. We'll talk in pharmacology in detail. So drugs like physostigmine and neostigmine bind with the acetylcholinesterases present at neuromuscular junction and reduce the catabolism or breakdown of the acetylcholine. So acetylcholine can accumulate in larger amount, and especially it's very useful in the patients with myasthenia gravis, right? So that larger amount of acetylcholine work on the remaining receptors, right, which are yet not blocked by the antibodies, and force them to work more and produce end plate potential strong enough to produce action potentials on the muscle cell membrane. Am I clear? Okay. There is another myasthenic disease which was not treated by this. There's another myasthenic disease in which antibodies were not found against
receptors.
Right? In that disease, immune system made antibodies, different type of antibodies, and these antibodies from the immune headquarters, these are autoantibodies which blocked these calcium channels. If autoantibodies block these calcium channels, action potentials will come, but do you think enough calcium will be influx will be there? Okay. If there's not enough calcium influx, do you think enough quanta of the acetylcholine will be released? Do you think neuromuscular transmission will be successful? So weakness will develop. This is another type of myasthenic syndrome. This myasthenic syndrome is not called myasthenia gravis. This is called, funny name, Eaton-Lambert, myasthenic syndrome. You really want to know how to differentiate them. There's a very interesting situation. If you have one patient with myasthenia gravis, for example, I have one patient here with myasthenia gravis, and I have one more patient here with Eaton-Lambert syndrome, simply Eaton-Lambert syndrome. Both of them have very much weakness. They find it very difficult to initiate the movement. Let's suppose you bring them on the dining table. Both of them are brought to the dining table. When myasthenic gravis patients start eating, in the beginning he is eating a little bit better, but with the time he becomes very, very weak. Is that right? And when you give him acetylcholine esterase blockers, his performance will go up. Is that right? Again, I will not, again, let me repeat it. That you have one patient who has myasthenia gravis, other patient who has Eaton-Lambert syndrome. Both are very happy to see the food. Both want to eat. But both of them start very slowly. Now, myasthenia gravis patient, as he eats, start very slowly in a fatigued manner, but within few minutes he become extremely fatigued. But Eaton-Lambert patient, he start in a very slow way, but gradually he improves. What could be the reason? Actually, when he start enjoying the food, more and more action potential come. So the few calcium channels which are left and spared of the antibodies, they bring more and more calcium. So calcium accumulate and better release occur. So this is a fatigue which its person start with a fatigue and gradually it becomes relieved, less severe problem. In myasthenia gravis, person start with the fatigue and he become more severe problem. Are you understanding it? But it's very difficult to remember who really got more active with the time. I have remember. Eaton-Lambert will eat the lamb even. Just give him enough time, he'll keep on eating and become more active. Is that right? But myasthenia gravis is in a very grave situation. You see the food, but it's like this. Even his eyelids will also droop like this. You get it now? So the purpose of all this thing is that there are two myasthenic syndromes. There are myasthenia gravis, there are myasthenic syndrome called Eaton-Lambert syndrome. Look at both of them and pair the neuromuscular transmission. One is working on postsynaptic membrane, other is working on presynaptic membrane. When autoantibodies bind with the postsynaptic membrane, right, then it is myasthenia gravis. When autoantibodies bind with the calcium channels in the presynaptic membrane, this is called Eaton-Lambert syndrome. Do you think it's difficult to understand? It's easy. Let's talk about some other drugs which work on this neurotransmission. There is a drug. You look at it. This drug can bind here and block the... very naughty and happy. It has blocked this pump. Choline uptake has been blocked, right? And if you give this drug, of course not a drug, it's a toxin, I think. If you give this thing to someone in high concentration, it goes and blocks the choline. What is this? It blocks the choline uptake mechanisms. Progressively, acetylcholine formation will drop. And eventually, what will happen? The release of acetylcholine will be reduced. And eventually, at this place, the end plate potentials will be produced less and muscles will develop weakness. This drug is called hemicholinium. Hemicholinium. Is that right? This is hemicholinium. Right? This is one step. Now you talk about another drug. There's another drug which can block this thing. What it is doing? It is working on the vesicle, and it work on the vesicle and does not allow the vesicle to does not allow the vesicle to concentrate the acetylcholine. So acetylcholine is not being concentrated in vesicles. So vesicles are overfilled or underfilled?
Underfilled.
And when the vesicles will move on stimulation, they will release less acetylcholine. The muscle weakness will develop. So what is the name of this drug, or more perfectly called toxin? This is called vesamecol. Vesamecol. Actually, look, the purpose of knowing all this neurotransmission is not just to pass or do some MCQs about this neuromuscular transmission. Purpose is you are becoming doctor. You should have a concept of how drugs are working and diseases are working around this area. Is that right? Yeah, MCQs are important, but your patients are not MCQs, remember. Average doctor is more worried about MCQs. A very good doctor, when he is in the making, he knows that if his knowledge is good, concepts are good, MCQs will be done as a byproduct. His concept should be aligned for the management of the patient, right? Anyway, so vesamecol. Then, have you heard of the botulinum toxin? There is a bacteria which produces the toxins, and those exotoxin, if you take it in food, your muscles will become floppy and paralyzed. Have you heard of that? Botulinum toxin, you never heard of it. Sometimes it is, these bacteria are present in honey. And mothers, I don't know why, they love their babies to give them honey. And if unfortunately some mother has given honey with botulinum toxin to the baby, baby will become floppy baby syndrome. How? Let me tell you. Even botulinum toxin is so toxic that you just imagine that actually, you know, the bacteria which produces botulinum toxin, that is anaerobic bacteria. So it loves to grow in canned food, food which is in the can, where we produce anaerobic environment, right? So if unfortunately this bacteria or its spores are packed into that can, they will multiply there and they produce exotoxin. And if you imagine in some restaurant food with that exotoxin is served, what will happen? Someone, you'll find one patient having a drooping of the upper eyelid, other is trying to talk and he cannot, one has a sagging of the face, you know, nerves are not working, muscles are not working, neuromuscular transmission, someone will just fall like this, and someone who has eaten more respiratory arrest will occur and he will die. You understand it? So how it really happens, how the toxin work? Look, that bacteria, I think it's a very deadly bacteria, is that right? That produces exotoxin. This is the exotoxin. Exotoxin is a very special type of cutter. This is a proteolytic enzyme. Botulinum toxin is a proteolytic enzyme, right? It can break down certain proteins. When botulinum toxin goes into your body and into your blood, these toxins through the blood, when they come across near choline uptake system, toxins love to bind with choline uptake system, and through that they come into nerve ending. So they concentrate into which nerve endings? At the nerve ending, cholinergic nerve ending, especially at the neuromuscular junctions. So when this toxin enters into your body, it is present all over the body in all fluids, but it's specially concentrated by cholinergic nerve ending at neuromuscular junctions. And once this toxin, right, you look at it, there's a bottle. I don't know how to make bottle. How I can make other beautiful things then? I don't know. I really am very poor in making bottle. But you just imagine this is a botulinum toxin with a lot of cutters. Is that right? And you know what do they cut? They cut down synaptobrevin and syntaxin. And you can understand what happened. The botulinum toxin is just concentrated by the nerve endings at neuromuscular junctions, and it goes over there and digests away by proteolytic process synaptobrevins and syntaxins. Signals are coming, calcium is coming, but vesicular proteins are not there to bind with the right membrane, and vesicles don't fuse, and release of acetylcholine is not there, and neuromuscular transmission fail. Nervous system failed to move the muscular system. Am I clear? That's my floppy baby syndrome. Right? We were moving step by step. What was this? Botulinum toxin. So, first of all, we talked about hemicholinium, which does not allow the choline to be uptaken. or we talked about vesicle. When hemicholine does not allow the choline to go and make acetylcholine, but if acetylcholine is made, vesicle does not allow it to be concentrated into that vesicle. And even if vesicles are ready and packed, then botulinum toxin does not allow them to fuse. Is that right? And even if all of that is done, let me tell you another thing. In South America, in some tribes, they were using special type of poisons to catch the fish. They throw that poison in the pond, and all the fish get paralyzed and come on the surface, and they just catch them and go home. And sometimes they put that poison on the arrows for their enemies, and enemy not only get injured by the arrows, he is unable to move.
Is that like the frogs? They rub it on certain frogs?
Pardon?
Frogs.
Yeah. Maybe you have found someone to rub on the frog, but this is your private matter. But what we are talking about, South American people, tribes, which used to catch the fish by that toxin, they used to put those poisons on the arrowheads, and so that they shoot the arrow, another person gets the injury, and then toxin goes into their body, and then the person gets paralyzed. That toxin, what that toxin was doing, look at it. Here is the, what is coming? Not arrow. And arrow is loaded with the toxin. It is loaded with the toxin. What this toxin is doing? This toxin might come into blood of the person or in the fish. Fish does not have blood, am I right? Or does it have? I'm not a specialist in fish. Anyway, so actually, any animal which has neuromuscular junctions dependent on this type of transmission, you know, now I'm trying to be diplomatic, right? So this toxin come into the body of that animal, this toxin will go, it will bind over here. With what? What is this? And it is like a cap. It caps this area. What do you think if they are capped? And look at it. What is this? It's a T. This T is, when they are capped, do you think acetylcholine can bind and stimulate? So this toxin, which is a T-shaped toxin, I must say, in our diagram, this toxin bind at postsynaptic membrane with the nicotinic cholinergic receptors. So neuromuscular transmission fail, and person or the organism will get paralyzed. The name of this toxin is, yeah, what is this, tubo? Tubocurari. These days we use it as a drug also. When we want to paralyze the patient during anesthesia, we give him tubocurari so that he does not fight with. Okay, we can call it also when someone is very emotional that it should be D tubocurari. Okay, he knows it is D tubocurari, right? So tubocurari or curari like drugs, right? They basically block the, what are these? Postsynaptic membrane and plate. Membrane having which receptors? Nicotinic cholinergic receptors blocked by the curare like drugs, right? Or the toxins. Am I right? So this is one way to produce paralysis. Doctors are also using one more type of drug these days if they want to produce the paralysis of muscle for a very short time. That is a funny way. You know, except, yeah, you want to ask something? Yeah, in the no, that is not used for anesthesia. That is used with anesthesia, general anesthesia. When we anesthetize the person, for example, you have to do operation in the abdomen. When you anesthetize the person, you want to relax his muscles, right? And if you give tubocurari, that help you to relax the muscles of the anesthetized patient, right?
Okay.
So that you can operate easily through his body, yes.
No, I was just wondering how would that be, I don't know.
Thank God it has a half-life, it is never there forever.
Okay.
Is that right? It will gradually get catabolized and away, right? Otherwise it will be very dead. It can kill the person if you give a toxic dose, right? But usually doctors don't give toxic dose, right? They give subtoxic dose, which is called dose in therapeutic region, therapeutic concentration. Then another thing is there. Look. There is another toxin, not toxin, drug. This is called succinylcholine. What is it?
Succinylcholine.
choline. Actually, this is a funny type of drug. It produces paralysis, but not by blocking these receptors. It produces paralysis by overstimulating these receptors. Now, you must be thinking what's happening. Let me tell you. Normally, look, acetylcholine comes. First, physiology, normal. Action potential come here, and acetylcholine release. Acetylcholine bind here, open the channel, produce local potential or produce end plate potential and produce action potential. But immediately after that, acetylcholine is destroyed by acetylcholine esterases. So acetylcholine produces transient stimulation, very short duration stimulation. Is that right? Now, succinylcholine is a drug which bind here and produce prolonged stimulation. If there's prolonged stimulation, then it means the sodium will keep on going for a long time. Initially, it will produce some action potential and muscles may show some fasciculation or twitching. But if it remains depolarized for a very long time, so it means this area will remain near the threshold for a very long time and all the sodium channels will be trapped into inactive state. As we have discussed in previous lectures in resting membrane potential and action potential, that if you keep the resting membrane potential of an excitable tissue all the time very near to threshold, then most of the voltage-gated sodium channels will be stuck into inactive state where they cannot be stimulated. So succinylcholine stimulates these channels and produces prolonged sustained depolarization, and slight depolarization of the membrane for a very long time lead to trapping of the voltage-gated sodium channels into inactive state. And do you think then action potential transmission will occur and that will block? So these are also neuromuscular blocker drug. But they block the neuromuscular transmission by depolarizing mechanism. Tubocurare is also neuromuscular drugs, but they block the neurotransmission by blocking the receptors. They reduce the function of receptors, and succinylcholine increase the function of receptors. Physiological normal function is receptors stimulated for very short time, and then it is responsible to produce end plate potential, then eventually action potentials. But tubocurare that blocks these receptors so severely that no end plate potentials are produced. And succinylcholine produced very prolonged end plate potential which keep on stimulating the, what is that, voltage-gated sodium channels, and they all get stuck into inactive state and they are not excitable. Is that right? So these are hypopolarizing neuromuscular blocker, and these are depolarizing neuromuscular blockers. They are depolarizing, prolonged depolarization but prolonged stimulation. Is that right? So how many clinical conditions we study around neuromuscular junction? Number one we talked about, okay, we'll talk about one by one. Number one we talked about myasthenia gravis. Here the autoantibodies were directed against presynaptic membrane or postsynaptic membrane? Postsynaptic membrane, you have to answer it. And exactly autoantibodies are directed against which component of postsynaptic membrane? Which receptor? Nicotinic cholinergic receptors. They are blocked in myasthenia gravis. And what kind of drugs are used for there? Which we studied the drug for myasthenia gravis. Acetylcholinesterase inhibitor, which are neostigmine and physostigmine in this condition. So that whatever acetylcholine is coming, it's not getting destroyed, and accumulated acetylcholine overstimulate the unblocked receptors and produce large enough end plate potential, right? Then we have talked about Eaton-Lambert syndrome. This is also myasthenic syndrome, but in this case, autoantibodies are not directed against postsynaptic membrane, they're directed against presynaptic membrane. Against which component of the presynaptic membrane? Calcium channels. So simply vesicles don't release. Then we talked about a drug called hemicholinium. In hemicholinium, what was happening? That in the nerve ending, choline uptake mechanisms were impaired, acetylcholine synthesis was impaired. Then there was another drug which was called vesamecol. And what it was doing, that whatever acetylcholine is synthesized, it does not allow the vesicular transporters to take that acetylcholine to vesicles. So vesicles remain underfilled, right? Then there was a drug. Yeah, what was that? No, before that there was these drugs we decided, botulinum toxin. Botulinum toxins. They destroy the synapto, bridges and syntaxins and similar proteins, so vesicles are unable to fuse with the neuronal membrane and a release of neurotransmitter fails. Then we talked about that, yes, tubocurare. This group of drugs simply blocks the nicotinic channels, cholinergic nicotinic channels, and end plate potentials are not formed with enough strength. And then the drug succinylcholine, which overstimulate for long prolonged duration, overstimulate the end plate potential receptors, which are end plate receptors are which are nicotinic cholinergic receptors. They are overstimulated for long time, then they prolong depolarization, lead to the failure of sodium voltage gated sodium channels, because they get stuck into an active state, and again there's paralysis. So out of these, how many of them are producing? This is autoimmune mediated weakness of the muscles on postsynaptic membrane. This is autoimmune mediated weakness produced by failure of presynaptic membrane actions. Hemicholinium is also producing weakness. Vesomecol is also producing weakness. Botulinum toxin also produces. Tubocurare also produces weakness. And succinylcholine also produces weakness. Am I clear? Only group which was producing stimulation was acetylcholinesterase inhibitors, which inhibit these enzymes and allow the acetylcholine to accumulate here and overstimulate, so that muscles can work well in myasthenic gravis patients. Do you have any question? Do you understand the clinical application of all this neuromuscular transmission? Class dismissed. Thank you.